I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Charles Larson's inside story of television murder. Someone's death. Starring George Kennedy, Joyce Boulafont, and Robert Reed. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Quaker State Motor Oil and the Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
This week, our story revolves around the make-believe world of television. We'll meet Nils Frederik Blixen, a middle-aged man married to his craft, producing television shows. He's preparing a new detective series called Stag at Bay, in which his star will have exactly 1/2 hour each week to solve a fictional crime. Nils Frederik Blixen, a veteran of the industry, is breaking in a new casting director, Joanna Redfern. Young, bright, aggressive. A woman more prideful of her liberated status than of her shocking red hair. Their problem is to cast the role of co-star in the upcoming series, strictly a matter of choice. It would have been easy if it hadn't been for one unexpected, intangible fact. Someone's death. The fact is, it was murder. Our story, Someone's Death, begins after this word.
He lay on his stomach under the oak like a spy, with his hand shading his eyes and a reversed blue baseball cap spread over the back of his neck. He was black, tall, 6'5" in his stocking feet, a former basketball player. Several woodworms had been caught in the blood that matted the base of his skull. He'd been shot at close range, the bullet burrowing upward through the back of his head. He was quite thoroughly, vengefully murdered. At the precise early morning hour that a young boy and girl in the hills along Mulholland Drive above Hollywood stumbled onto the body, I was in a projection room at the studio. I was still at the studio in my office, chairing an unofficial production meeting as the sun dipped into the smog and below the Los Angeles horizon. It was the 22nd of May. On June the 4th, come hell, high water, death, panic, or war, we had to be in production on the first of 22 hour episodes of a new TV series which I had originated and would produce called Stag at Bay, a detective series which is supposed to make me some kind of authority on murder. The meeting was a replay of 1,000, just like it.
You know, we've got to find a gimmick to hang the PR campaign on.
Right now, that's less important than finding the right girl.
Across the desk from me was Leonard Ellis, a born conciliator. In his youth, he'd wanted to be a baseball umpire, but failed due to his slight deafness, though he often said it was merely compensation for 20/20 vision. He claimed to hear better after a nip, so at 61, he had become an alert quasi-alcoholic. Nevertheless, Leonard Ellis was the best unit publicist any series could have. Joanna Redfern, the casting director, sat near him, upright in a straight chair. Tall, 23, a recent graduate of Bennington, she wore her red hair short because everybody else wore it long. She was uptight, tapping the arms of her chair, uncrossing her trousered legs. When she finally got to her feet, it was in sections, like a deck chair unfolding.
Well, someday some terribly courageous TV producer is going to thumb his nose at the computer, cast the best actor or actress in his series instead of the safest, and make $100 million. And how in the name of reason are those pious, rude New York network research freaks going to squeeze out of that one?
Well, I'm sure every producer wants to cast the best actor or actress in every role. Isn't that so, Niels Frederick?
I'm producing this series, and I'll make the decisions. I couldn't care less about what they want upstairs. And so you'll get it straight, Miss Redfern. I'm not going to fill an important running lead with a bad Mexican-American actress just because Justicia or Nosotras or the rest of the pressure groups think I ought to.
The part calls for a Mexican-American girl. It would be absurd not to get...
Fine. You bring me one who can cut the mustard and I'll sign her.
I have brought you several, but all you're after is a pretty face.
They weren't right, any of them.
You know what I think I better do is tell the front office that this isn't working out, that it isn't fair to the studio to saddle you with a casting director you don't know and you don't have confidence
in. Sit down.
No, I'd rather not.
Who's for coffee? Are you, Nils Frederick?
All the same, Mr. Blixen, I wish you luck. I hope Staggett Bay knocks everybody right on their backside.
His backside.
Of course.
Is this your first series, Miss Redfern?
Yes.
It's my fifth. Joanna, isn't it?
It's Joanna, but everybody calls me Red.
Yours is black, I believe, Nils Frederick. Red, are you, cream?
No sugar, dash of cream.
While Ellis translated the coffee order to my secretary, Mary, the poor woman should have been gone hours ago, Red sat on her tailbone with the player's directory and searched for the actress who wouldn't compromise us too much with the powers upstairs. I could hear Ellis on the extension talking to his granddaughter.
Hello, honey? Yeah. This is Grandpa. I'm going to be late again for dinner. Did you call me? Donnie Osmond? I thought you were in love with David Cassidy. Issue of... Which magazine? Oh. Anything with Donnie's picture on the cover. Yeah, I'll find one. I won't be too late. Bye-bye, sweet.
Donnie's woman?
Donnie needs her.
She assured me last spring that Bobby Sherman needed her.
Well, that's when she was a kid of 13. But now she knows what love is.
Red, where did you meet Ellis's granddaughter?
Oh, I've known Heidi for years. We're neighbors.
You're kidding. No one in Hollywood has neighbors.
Oh, Red and I live in the same... what do you call it, Red? Fourplex?
Over under Long Pre. It's a nice area. I love it.
Yeah, they still dig their heels in about blacks, though.
In this enlightened day and age.
Yeah, you bet. In this day and age... I'm sorry, Red.
Why? Did I walk into something? Well, what happened at the neighborly fourplex?
Nothing happened.
Yeah, right. Nothing. But, tempest in a teapot.
Come on, tell me. Might springboard a script.
No script. Just I had a black friend, somebody objected.
Anonymous letters, you know.
So what did you do about it, Red?
Kissed him goodnight on the lawn after that. Didn't want anybody to miss anything.
That's a good girl.
Oh, here she is. Now, just look at this picture if you want to see one sweet actress. Now, I know she won't do. You're after a beauty. This girl looks like 10 cents worth of cat meat.
Yeah. Got an interesting face.
You mean ugly.
True.
You know Clifford Odette's Country Girl?
Of course I know it. Do you think I'm illiterate?
Well, how do you think the woman ought to be played?
Mother Earth.
Okay. I saw Isabel Chavez do Country Girl in Spanish in East L.A. a month ago, and I thought I'd die. This was a woman you could believe anything about. When the husband tells the director she was Miss Mexico, you believe. When he says she tried suicide, you believe that. You believe. Oh, nuts.
I watched her. Joanna Redfern, Miss Clumsy of the Year, knock over a 7-foot-tall philodendron plant. While Ellis and I helped her prop it up again, she was tossing the plant's upper tendrils over the automatic fire extinguisher pipes in the ceiling, which caused her to split her shirt and dislodge an abstract of some English soccer players when she fell in exhaustion against the wall.
Oh, shoot.
Yet, like the young Hepburn, she was so secure in her ungainliness that it projected itself as a kind of high-born grace. I felt I'd never been stuck with a more aggravating girl in my life.
Oh, I did all that in one take.
Will you sit down, Red? Forget the plant. Just sit down. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have shouted.
You certainly shouldn't have.
Ellis, see if Mary fell in the coffee pot out there and drowned, will you?
Yeah. Mary.
Oh, dear.
Oh, sorry. I didn't know you were right in the door about to knock. Here, let me help you.
Joanna.
Hmm? Oh, me, yeah? Oh, I get so used to being called Red.
Yeah.
What is it, Mary?
Well, I hate to interrupt, but I've got a message for Joanna.
Who is it? Tell him to hold the line. We'll be through here in a minute.
Well, actually, they're right outside.
Look, Mary, if it's some agent...
They're not agents, exactly.
Well, who are they exactly? Bill collectors, men from Mars, what?
No, they're policemen.
Policemen? This is a private eye show. Tell them we're not casting men in rules. Right, Nils Frederick?
You don't understand. They're...
Well, come on, Mary. They're what?
Detectives.
Detectives?
And they want to talk to me?
Yes.
What about?
They said it's something about a murder.
The two plainclothesmen were standing by Mary's files, a stocky, sunburned man in suede pants and a modified safari jacket, and a lean, dark man wearing a gray business suit. The second detective extended his wallet. I studied the ID, which bore a serious pose of him in a square collar, tie, and somewhat shorter haircut. The card said, Ames, Sergeant, Negro, male, 5'11", weight 160, black hair, brown eyes, no visible scars. There was a third man in the outer office, a cab driver, who sat flipping his hat between his hands and whistling at the floor, his elbows on his knees. Mary explained his presence.
He's been waiting for over half an hour. Miss Redfern, Joanna, ordered him.
Both men in red went through the open door into my office. As I turned to follow them, a messenger boy dropped off the rewrite of our opening show. The cabbie, I noticed, was leaning around me trying to read the cover.
You a TV producer?
That's what they call me. Mary, will you Xerox this, 15 copies?
Right now?
No, in the morning.
She's not in trouble, is she, Joanna?
Ellis, drive Mary out to the lot.
Don't worry, Red. All they can do is rubber hose you.
Stupid thing for Ellis to have said to her. I liked Red. I could see Ames was quizzing her tough. Whether they resented it or not, I was going to go in. The cabbie was stretching his neck to try and see into the room. I closed the door.
The last time you saw him was...
Is this private?
It's up to the young lady.
They know about Daniel and me.
Daniel?
The black friend I mentioned. Dan Gladstone. Apparently he's been in some kind of accident.
Oh?
2 weeks. You haven't seen Mr. Gladstone since roughly the 8th of May, then?
No, I haven't. Or longer.
Why not?
I don't know what you mean.
You were fairly close friends, weren't you, Miss Redfern?
We were friends. I don't know how close.
Were you engaged?
No.
Didn't Gladstone give you a ring sometime in February?
It was a joke. It came out of a penny candy jar.
Excuse me. But what kind of accident was this?
He was shot in the back of the head.
Shot? Daniel,
And no accident.
Well, who told you about the ring?
What was the tenor of your last meeting, Miss Redfern?
The what?
What did you talk about?
I don't remember.
Did you fight?
I just really can't remember.
Did you say if you show your black face around here again, I'll cut your damn woolly head off, or words to that effect?
Now, wait a minute. Have you warned her, given her her rights, or did you just forget?
No, we didn't forget.
She has a right to know who you've been talking to, who's been telling you these...
Do you own a .22 caliber pistol, Miss Redfern?
Okay, that does it. Give me an outside line.
A pistol? No, of course not.
Red, cool it. I'm contacting a lawyer. You don't mind, do you, gentlemen?
No, I think it's a very sound idea.
I don't need a lawyer.
You might ask him to meet us at North Hollywood Division. That's 11480 Tierra. You have her there in a half hour, Mr. Blixen.
Murder on television is one thing. It's an episode. By the end of the last reel, it's solved. But I was discovering that isn't the way it really is. My guts were turning.
Hello?
Wade?
Yes.
Wade, this is Nils Frederick.
Nils, what's the matter? You sound like you were canceled before you started.
Wade, we've got a problem here.
Oh, like what?
Like a suspect for murder. The city by night had a warm, wind-swept face. Los Angeles was a Mediterranean town, I'd always felt, despite its size and location. All day long, it lay like a girl on its back by the sea, half asleep under its dark glasses burning in the sun, amused by the boys who whistled and hung around. Only at dusk it began to stir. It would blink and sit up and rest its chin on its knees, gazing at the bronze-colored ocean, and perhaps accept a margarita or two. The cab driver didn't need a margarita. He was very talkative.
Boy, looks like all the idiots are out tonight. Hey, look at that coot. Hey, there's a real dilly. You know, I tell you, I love this town. Too breezy back there for you?
No, it's fine.
Are you all right, Red?
You haven't asked me whether I did it or not. Do you realize that?
I haven't. All right, did you shoot the man?
No.
That's a load off my mind.
Hey, did you see that jerk? A left turn and no signal. My wife wonders why I got a nervous stomach. Hey, you two want to buy a free press?
No, thanks. Would you mind... What is your name?
Jack. I thought I told you.
The young lady and I have some things to talk about.
Oh, sure, sure. Private is private.
You think I'm not the murderous type, then?
If there is a type.
There's a type that goes all to pieces in a jealousy situation. The first person I was jealous of was my sister. I was 4 when she was born. I couldn't understand why my father had done that to me.
Don't you blame your mother, too?
She didn't count. She died when I was 8. She and my father were separated by then. He was living in Pennsylvania. She was in Hartford.
With you and your sister?
No. I'd already killed my sister.
You what?
I broke my sister's neck when she was 7 months old.
When you set out to make a point, you don't fool around.
It's the fact. My mother left the carriage on the front porch. I pushed it down the steps. I wasn't punished. Just sent to a child psychiatrist and later to a very nice school in New Hampshire. That's what jealousy can do. My father used to come see me once in a while. He's married twice since my mother died. 3 more children.
I thought you said you hadn't been punished. We rode along for a while, neither of us talking. Even the cab driver seemed more content since traffic had eased up some. I studied Red during the silence. She struck me as being very vulnerable.
Do you have any children?
No.
I know you're married. I looked up your studio biography.
Well, then it's out of date. We were divorced in 65.
Oh, let's see. I was born in 50, so I was 15 then. I'm sorry it didn't work out.
We made a mistake and we rectified it.
Very civilized.
My dear girl, a divorce is about as civilized as a gang rape. We've been married 18 years.
I think there must be something wrong with marriage.
Not with the game, just with the players.
Ah, this must be the place.
Keep it running, Jack. We'll be going back into Hollywood.
Hey, I'll tell you what I'll do. Why don't I grab something to eat and then I'll come back for you, huh? You don't want to buy the cab. wait a minute. What is this, a check? I'm sorry, we don't take personal checks.
A voucher. I ride cabs a lot.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, thanks, Mr. Blixen.
Try us in about an hour.
Sure.
Niels Frederick, come over here. Wade Shriver, your client, Joanna Redfern.
How do you do?
Joanna? Is it Miss?
Yes.
Let's talk out here for a minute. I think before we go inside, we'd better clarify a couple of points.
I didn't kill Dan.
Yes, I understand that. I don't believe they're ready to accuse you of it. They're just trying to get to the truth, believe it or not. They said he was shot with a .22. Yes, he was, and that's point number one. Joanna, do you own a .22?
No.
Ever own one?
No.
Well, were you ever in contact with one?
No.
Okay, I'll buy that. Second, where were you last evening between, say, 10 and midnight?
10, Grauman's Chinese.
You went to a movie?
Yes.
Wade, you act like a cop. Now, come on, Niels, wait a minute. Who did you go to the movie with?
Alone.
You often go to the movies alone?
Not often. I was just walking on Hollywood Boulevard. My car's in the shop. And I just went in.
Where was he killed, Wade? On the valley side of the hills. You know that area?
Not too well.
Well, there's a dead-end private street off Barry. It's called Ruby.
Oh, I know Ruby.
You would. Some kids found the corpse this morning by the side of the road, dead about 12 hours. How do you know Ruby Avenue?
Oh, Lord.
Boy, come on. How do you know it?
Oh, we used to park up there.
You and Gladstone?
Once in a while.
Had the body been dumped?
No, his car was nearby. He was found about 20 feet from it. Hadn't been robbed, no sign of a struggle. So he knew his killer. He just strolled over under the trees, lowered his head, and somebody reached around and shot him.
What's the matter, Ed? You cold?
Just a chill. I'll get over it.
There seems to be a witness report on file here.
Witness to what?
Evidently, somebody heard you threaten Dan Gladstone.
Threaten him? That's ridiculous.
Joanna, did you two fight at all?
Well, I wouldn't say fight.
Well, what would you say?
Well, we had words.
What about?
But nothing important. Does it matter?
It matters. Now, please, Red. It must have been fairly important if it caused you two to break up.
He was a pusher, and he tried to get me hooked. I loved him, or I thought I loved him, but I told him to get lost.
Did you tell him, if you show your black face around here, I'll cut your head off?
Oh, God. Yes, I did.
Wade, what does this do to us?
Well, I don't know, Nils. Sure gives him a peach of a motive to swing on. Well, we better go in.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Someone's Death. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Television producer Nils Frederik Blixen is an expert at solving murders of the fictional variety. But he's found that it's nothing at all like the real thing. The real thing keeps you awake nights, drives you in endless circles, and cannot be solved in a half-hour time slot. The police have taken away his young female casting director, Joanna Redfern, who at this point has been cast herself in the leading role in a very real murder. But for Nils Frederik Blixen, Joanna is all wrong for the part, even though he now knows she's played it once before. Someone's Death continues in a moment.
Inside the North Hollywood police station, the detectives took Red into a poster-encrusted cubicle from which I was barred. She cast me a ghastly grin just before the door closed in my face, and I felt my heart give an unaccustomed lurch. I paced back and forth along the short hallway until a sunburned civilian in overalls took pity on me and urged me not to worry about my daughter, since the Valley police were gentlemen through and through. I thanked him and went outside, cut to the quick. She could be my daughter, damn it. I became obsessed with the idea that something had gone wrong and that they were booking her. I told myself I'd count to 10. Schreiber came out on the count of 7, joking and chatting with Sergeant Ames. Red was pale but composed. Ames went back inside, and Schreiber gave me the rundown.
No, it was a breeze. They didn't know about Gladstone being a pusher, so I didn't mention it. No, they didn't suspect her any more than they suspect the governor. Well, come on, Red, I'll take you home.
Wait a second, Wade. Don't you still live way out in West Valley?
Tarzana, yeah. What's the difference? I can take Red into Hollywood and then swing over Coldwater.
I wouldn't hear of it.
I have ordered a cab.
Oh. Okay, Nils Frederik, I get the message. Well, I'll call you tomorrow, Red. We'll have dinner one night. You doing anything Saturday?
No.
Good, it's a date. And, good night, buddy.
Good night, buddy. Give my love to all your kids.
Sweet man.
My company's lawyer. We've been friends for years. Let's walk to the corner. Maybe there's a cab stand there or a bus.
How old is he?
30, 31.
You mentioned something about kids?
He's got 4.
Holy Moses.
Hey, cab! Oh, Jack! Oh, Jack!
Nice wife, I suppose.
She's not married. She died.
Hey, I'm sorry I'm late. I was hungrier than I thought. Hey, you're a producer. Any chance of getting studio work?
Transportation? You'd have to check with the union.
Ah, forget it. Maybe I'll go back to school. Landscape architecture. I used to work for a Japanese nursery up in Montrose. Boy, that really turns me on, Japanese gardens. You know what I mean? You know what a haiku is?
Japanese poem. 3 lines, 17 syllables. Quote, white cherry blossoms, colder than snow when I call, and you are not there.
Oh, son of a gun.
That's your own composition?
birthday present from an ex-friend of mine. Very dark friend. I'll make a right turn onto Long Prairie, Jack.
Hey, Miss Redfern, the secretary told me you didn't have a car. You get off work around the same time every night. I'm usually someplace near the studio. I could pick you up on a regular basis, you know?
I have a car. It's just in the garage now, but thanks.
How about picking me up? I don't have a car. I'll write you a free haiku every fifth trip.
The heck with the haikus. I do it for the money alone. What time?
6.
Oh, right here. The big brown fourplex on the left.
Now, wait for me. I won't be long.
No, I can't. My wife will kill me. Look, I'll take another voucher. That's 310. Pick you up tomorrow at 6, Mr. Blixen.
I was glad for the opportunity to be alone with her. We stood on the sidewalk a moment while she gave me a rundown on the tenants in the building, pointed out where she lived, on the second floor. Downstairs right was where Leonard Ellis and his granddaughter Heidi lived.
Odd little girl.
How odd?
She never blinks, for one thing. She's 14 going on 45. I spent age 14 in tears. Maybe that's why I distrust her so much. She doesn't cry. Never needs comforting.
What happened to her parents?
They were both in the army. Killed themselves. It was horrible. Ellis had to take over. He adopted her. I hinted to him once he ought to send her to an analyst. He almost hit the ceiling. She lives on comic books. Got them piled in the garage so high you can't get a car in. She's very spiritual around her grandfather. But twice now, I caught her burning grasshoppers to death with a magnifying glass.
She sounds like a charmer. Could Heidi have heard your argument? Was she at home that night?
She's always home. She's always around.
I followed Red up toward the fourplex. It was a house that only could have felt comfortable in Southern California. Curved red Spanish tiles lay on the flat roof like a matador's hat on an Iowa woman. There was a moving blur on the porch swing. She was an unmemorable girl, Heidi, half hidden behind long flaxen hair that fell to her bosom. At odd moments, she'd nudge some of the hair away from the left side of her face. I never saw the right. She wore jeans, a checkered shirt that hung out, covering her thick waistline, and painted toenails.
Hi. Aren't you in bed? Oh, this is my boss, Mr. Blixen. This is Heidi.
Hello, Heidi. I knew your grandfather. He works for me.
Do you know Donny Osmond?
No, I'm afraid I don't. I know the Lone Ranger, though. He's a fine man.
You know why the Lone Ranger and Tonto broke up?
No, why?
He found out what Kemosabe really meant. That's a joke song.
It's a real thigh slapper.
Well, where's everybody?
They're all in Boom Boom's playing cards. Did the Fuzz find you?
They found me. Were they here?
I don't know.
Of course you know. You talked to them.
They said you killed Dan Gladstone. Did you know Peter Lorre?
Heidi, what's the trouble between you and me? Well, then, don't answer.
Did you ever see anybody so clumsy in your life?
But beautiful.
Red? She curdles my milk. Think she's the queen of Sheba. I hate her. I really hate her.
You know who she looks a lot like? Your mother.
My mother? Oh, you never saw my mother.
Well, there's a picture of her on your grandpa's desk in her whack uniform. What was her name?
Florence.
Maybe you hate Red because she reminds you of Florence.
You're nuts. If she reminded me of my mother, I'd love her because I love my mother.
Even after she left you. Did you tell the police about Red's and Dan's argument? Did you tell them about the ring he gave her from the candy jar?
What's the difference?
Well, I suppose it was the last time you saw Dan, the day of the argument.
He came around one more time, about a week ago, last Tuesday.
To see Red?
She was at work.
Who'd he come to see then?
I don't know. Nobody was home.
You were home?
Well, I wasn't to begin with. I got sick at school, and the nurse excused me, came home. I really felt terrible.
And Dan was here?
Yeah, around the back.
Well, what did you talk about? Now, it might be important, Heidi.
Did you know Boris Karloff? Lon Chaney? You sure you didn't know Peter Lorre?
Heidi, think about what I said about the resemblance. She just sat there, her arms wrapped around her body. Never had I seen such malevolence on the face of anyone so young. I thought about what she'd said about hating Red. I believed she really meant it. As Heidi said, everyone was in Boom Boom's apartment. Of course, it was a little tough getting in because the Hayworths, Boom Boom and her husband Fred, leery of burglars, had put a new safety catch on the flimsy door earlier in the evening. And for a while, none of the people inside could work it. And while we waited for them to figure it out, Red gave me a rundown on whom I would meet.
Boom Boom owns the building. She lives in this flat with her fifth husband, Fred, and her ex-lover, Preston Andrade.
It sounds like a comfortable arrangement.
They're all in their 60s now. It's more like two brothers and a sister. Then there's Phil, Boom Boom's nephew. He dropped out of high school. His father kicked him out. She took him in.
A school kid. Prime customer for a pusher. Incidentally, where did you meet Dan Gladstone?
Arcadia Playhouse. I saw him in a play. He was good. You'll be crazy about Boom Boom. She used to dance naked on a drum in Paris. That's how she got her name and lost her hearing.
Oh, sorry, folks. Come on in.
Everybody, meet my boss.
Fred Hayworth, the master mechanic, was a tall, bald man in undershirt and gray pants who kept scratching nervously and had kindly, bloodshot eyes. When he offered me a cigar and I took it, he seemed startled. And all the time I was there, he didn't say a word. He left the conversation to his wife's ex-lover, Andrade, who knew me from Warner Brothers, he said. Worked in wardrobe, which I should have spotted on sight from the way he dressed. Italian shoes, tight pants, a silk shirt, and a thick black toupee, gray at the temples. Phil, the nephew, was a quiet kid whose yellow hair burst from his head like the flame of a newly lighted match. Worked in a drugstore, he told me. When I asked Phil if he liked his job better than music, Andrade answered for him. Andrade seemed to answer for everyone.
How did you know about Phil's music?
The guitar, right?
Uh-huh.
His fingertips, the calluses. Add the guitar case in the corner and I come on like an instant Sherlock Holmes.
Or Saul Stagg.
Who's Saul Stagg?
That's his new detective. Starts on network television in the fall.
Oh, Murphy's playing that.
The voice came from behind me. There were two of them. Red introduced them as René Ortiz and his friend Bobby. René was a frail, heavy-headed Frenchman who powder-coated his blue chin. His friend Bobby was a lot younger, higher-strung, covered with little gifts, rings on both hands, a silver bracelet, St. Christopher's medal on a thin golden chain around his neck. Bobby, you said you knew my star, Murph Smith. Where from?
Oh, around here and there, parties.
The Acadia Playhouse?
Mm-hmm.
But you're an actor, then?
Well, theoretically. René doesn't like me to work.
I understand Dan Gladstone belonged to the Acadia.
Oh, did he? Yes. You know, I believe he did. I think I do remember Gladstone there. Of course, there were so many of us. I knew Danny casually.
René spit one word out, casually, turned and whipped into the kitchen. I felt René's jealousy bordered on violence. Red smiled at me, took my arm, and guided me in to meet Boom Boom. And I, Nils Frederick Blixen, got drunk on Boom Boom Hayworth that night in Hollywood and never recovered. It was love at first sight. She had never been a beautiful woman, and now at 60-odd, she was big-hipped, rattled-looking, and quite deaf. But there was enough left in her violet eyes and the seductive way she used her hands to effectively tongue-tie a stronger man than I. She wore a green gambler's eyeshade over her dyed jet-black hair. She sat at a round table covered by a blanket and a multitude of poker chips and extended both hands to me as gently as a child touching a pony's nose.
How nice.
How do you do, Boom Boom?
Oh, you don't have to shout, chérie.
I'm not that Jeff. So you are the one who saved our dear Joanna from the San Flick.
Oh, no, 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 no. Let me correct that. I didn't save her from anything. The police simply began questioning Red because she and Dan Gladstone were... had been going together.
Listen, we didn't mean to break up your poker game when we came in.
I know. Of course. You two go upstairs and have fun, no? Good luck on your new series. Your name again?
Blixen.
No, no, no. We are friends.
Nils Frederick.
Nils Frederick. Charming.
Thank you, Bumbo.
Andrade, get me a cigarette. Who's your leading actor, Cherie?
A young man named Murphy Smith.
I'd love to meet him.
When we get into production, you come on out.
I'd adore it. It's a date. You, come. You kiss my cheek, huh?
Good night.
Night, everybody.
We're glad you stopped in. Bye.
Well, what'd you think?
I think that Phil could have a motive if he's deeply involved with narcotics.
No, I meant what did you think about Boom Boom?
Oh, fantastic. There was no sign of the cab and the porch swing was empty. Heidi was gone. I filled my lungs with jasmine scent and then climbed to the second landing to Red's apartment. She'd gone up a moment or two before me to fix us each a drink. When I came in, I could hear her in the kitchen, knocking things over. She came out with two scotches, neat.
I called your cab again. The woman said that he was on the way. Cheers.
Cheers.
It must be awful not to have a car in this town. I don't know how you manage.
Well, you were lucky not to have had one last night.
Last night?
Gladstone's murderer drove to and from the ambush. Your car was in the shop.
Yes. Well, to be 100% candid...
It wasn't in the shop.
No, it was in the shop, all right. Oh, hell, they'll find out anyway. I borrowed Renee's.
Naturally.
It's almost as if a malignant fate were pursuing me, isn't it?
Did you tell Wade Schreiber this?
About malignant fate?
About having Renee's car?
No, I didn't. I will, though, I promise, soon as I see him.
Tell me about the letter, the anonymous letter concerning you and Gladstone.
What about it? It's just one of those hateful, illiterate ravings. It didn't make any sense.
What did you do with it?
I tore it up.
Which one did it threaten, you or Gladstone?
Both of us.
If he ever came back again or if you ever saw him again, is that the idea?
More or less.
And Gladstone did come back, and now he's dead.
Well, you can't call that cause and effect, because he certainly never came back after I booted him out.
Oh, but he did.
When?
Last Tuesday.
How do you know?
Heidi told me.
Oh.
Don't you believe her?
Oh, well, let me put it this way. Heidi romanticizes.
All right. Indulge me. Assume she was telling the truth for once. Who would he have come to see? Boom Boom?
Maybe he was crazy about Boom Boom.
What'd she think of him?
He was a man. She approved.
Did Boom Boom's husband, what was his name, Fred, did he approve?
Fred believes in letting people do as they please. Fred isn't even jealous of Andrade. Why should he have fussed about Danny?
Preston Andrade isn't black.
Oh, nobody around here cares about that.
Jealousy isn't always justified. Remember?
If you're referring to my sister, that's rotten.
I'm sorry. Did you notice anything peculiar about young Phil downstairs, like his barbiturate eyes? Let's say he makes a decision one day. He decides he loves his music more than his downers. He tells his suppliers to bug off. The supplier threatens to tell Phil's aunt. Phil tries to scare him away with a letter. It doesn't work. You want another?
Well, if you insist on playing detective.
I do. 2 points. First, Ellis was wrong. There were blacks living around here, to my knowledge, as far back as the 40s. So the objection to Dan wasn't from that quarter. Point two, the letter made a threat, and the threat was carried out. That scares me.
Because we're dealing with a nut?
We could be. Where are you going, Red?
To get the letter.
But I thought...
I lied.
In a moment she was back. She dropped the letter into my hand. It was wrinkled and dirty. Someone, Red presumably, had crumpled it at one time into a ball and then smoothed it out again. Words cut from cheap magazines had been pasted in soiled, uneven rows. I read it aloud. Dear Jade, tell your black paramour to clear out or we'll cut off... It's a gruesome threat. Interesting words, though.
The ones you mmmed over?
No. Paramour and Jade. Red, this letter threatens your life, and you didn't ever think of showing it to the police? Who all handled this letter?
Well, everybody. Dan, me, Boom Boom, Fred, Andrade, Renee, everybody in this house. What are you thinking about, fingerprints?
Oh, not much need to hurry on that now. I'd like to borrow it, may I?
Sure.
Good night.
Good night, Niels Frederick.
She moved forward, trod on my toe, and kissed me softly on the cheek. But as I went down the stairs, I couldn't drive from my mind the distressing realization that she had lied to the police about not having a car last night. She had lied to me about the threatening letter. And what else had she lied about? The image of her pushing her baby sister's carriage down the steps blotted everything else out.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Someone's Death. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Metropolitan Life Insurance, Hallmark Cards, and V8 Juice. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
I've been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.